It's an event that only happens every 17 years. Right now, billions, perhaps trillions of cicadas are digging their way out of the dirt where they've been living for almost 20 years. They will shed their hard skins, climb to the treetops, mate, and then die, all in a four-week period. But why? The NewsHour's John Yang begins our coverage of the 2021 Brood 10 cicada emergence.
Let's see if we can find somebody under here, maybe.
Entomologist Mike Raup, a.k.a. the Bug Guy, and I are hunting cicada in his neighbor's backyard in Columbia, Maryland.
Oh, boy, there we go. Look at that. Oh, yeah.
Specifically, Raup, his neighbor Tim Hughes, and I, by the way, all of us are fully vaccinated, along with Hughes' three-year-old granddaughter Emily, were looking for brood 10 cicadas.
What do you think?
Pretty good?
Good.
Yeah? He's pretty cute, isn't he?
We dug up the cicadas and then put them back. But soon we won't have to look very hard for them. They'll climb out from holes in the ground after 17 years below the surface. And there will be a lot of them.
You know, 12, 13, 14 holes, that's probably going to translate in an acre to several hundred thousand of cicadas per acre.
Wow. So.
Just in this backyard.
It is going to be crazy. There are literally going to be billions, if not trillions, of periodical cicadas emerging in 15 states from Georgia to New York City and then west to the Mississippi River, Ohio, Indiana, and Illinois.
North American periodical cicadas emerge together in groups called broods in distinct geographic areas after spending 13 or 17 years underground. Brood 10 is one of the biggest and will come out when the soil reaches 64 degrees.
These guys have been underground for 17 years, sucking on the sap of tree roots. They're gonna make a jailbreak just at nightfall. Their skin is gonna split open on the back. They're gonna pop out of there, then they're gonna move to the safety of the treetops. Then within a span of about maybe a week or 10 days, it's gonna be a big boy band because only the males sing.
And they are loud. Up to 100 decibels. That's as noisy as a lawnmower.
John, it's gonna be all about romance at that time. Remember, these are teenagers. They're 17 years old. They've been underground. It's been dismal. Once they're up in the treetops, he's gonna do his very best to convince that special someone that she should be the mother of his nymphs. If she likes it, she's gonna flick her wings. They're gonna hook up. They're gonna mate. It's just gonna be wonderful.
The females lay their eggs in small tree branches, and then the grown-ups die. After the eggs hatch, the nymphs fall to the ground, burrow into the soil, and start the cycle all over again.
These are the very parents of the class of 2021.
Raup saved some cicadas from the last emergence in 2004.
We have two different species in the box right now. These are called the septemdecims, where these little guys right here, those are my favorites. Those are called the cassinis.
Chris Hughes remembers feeling overwhelmed 17 years ago.
It's just dramatic how many there were. Literally, the entire yard was moving. In fact, it was moving so much that we got up. And you know how you feel when you get off a boat? You're a little woozy? That's exactly how we felt.
Instead of sea legs, you had cicada legs.
Cicada legs, yes.
These are from Long Island.
Evolutionary biologist Chris Simon says there's a reason for their abundance.
When they come up, everything eats them. They have this sort of safety in numbers strategy. Eventually, predators get tired of eating them, and enough are left that they can survive and reproduce. And so they'll all come out at exactly the same time.
Cicadas have even become cultural icons. Simon showed us souvenirs like this jade cicada.
They've traditionally been put in the mouths of dead people in Asia to carry their spirits into the next world. This is a bumper sticker from Nashville. This one says, "Sing, mate, die." Cicadas are also really well loved in Japan. This can transform into a robot. It's called Cicadacon.
But periodical cicadas may be transforming in real life. Simon is studying whether climate change is spurring them to mature faster.
We've seen many more cicadas coming out 4 years early, and not only coming out 4 years early, but coming out 4 years early in larger numbers, and they mate and lay eggs, and the eggs hatch. In previous years, we've seen them come out 4 years early, but there weren't as many. They don't establish a self-reproducing population, so we used to think it was an evolutionary dead end.
But not anymore. In 2017, Simon tracked brood 10 cicadas that emerged 4 years early and estimates there were millions of them.
With climate change, there's warming, and the warming provides longer growing seasons for the trees and for the cicadas. And so as the feeding season gets longer, the cicadas can grow up faster.
The brood 10 emergence will give Simon a chance to collect new data. But for those who may fear the appearance of billions of bugs?
They're not going to bite. They're not going to sting. They're not going to grab dogs and small children like the monkeys in The Wizard of Oz and fly away with them. These are harmless creatures.
Ralph cannot wait for Cicada Palooza.
This is like having a National Geographic special right in your own backyard. It's going to have birth. It's going to have death. It's going to have romance in the treetops. It's going to have cicadas battling predators. It's going to be better than an episode of Game of Thrones.
So sit back and enjoy the show. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Yang.
Did you know that you can actually eat cicadas? Here's one part of John's interview with Mike Raup that didn't end up in the piece, but it's still pretty interesting if you can stomach it.
I like to eat what we call the soft-shelled cicada. So as soon as they molt, their exoskeleton is not hardened. And I usually try to select those that either are not going to survive. Many will tumble to the ground. Some will get stuck in their exoskeleton. So I'll take those ones and just dine on them. They've got kind of a buttery texture and a nutty flavor, probably from the tannins of the tree roots they fed on for 17 years. And they'd probably be really good with like a Merlot. There are lots of ways to fix cicadas. Back in 2004, one of our graduate students wrote what we call the Cicadalicious Cookbook. It's chock-a-block full of cicada recipes. This weekend, I'm gonna make some emergence cookies. It's like a chocolate chip. It's got a little cicada nymph in the middle. It's kind of good, and they'll be a lot of fun to eat. There's also recipes for chirper tacos in there, so you're going to mix them up with your taco seasoning, put them on a taco shell with some cheese and some lettuce. They're going to be very good as well. One caution we do have, if folks have an allergy to shrimp or prawns, because that allergen is shared between those arthropods and cicadas, please don't eat cicadas. If you're going to eat cicadas, we recommend that rather than throw them in a pot of boiling water or blanching them like, you know, those lobsters just hate it when you do it, maybe put them in the freezer, and this will be a more humane way to prepare them for your meal.
This isn't the first time Brood 10 has emerged, and this isn't the first time the NewsHour has bugged out over the phenomenon. So let's take a trip back in time, 17 years back, to see how Jeffrey Brown covered their last emergence in 2004.
It's called Magic Cicada, the Magic Cicada, because it performs an astounding feat, disappearing for many years in a regular cycle and then suddenly reappearing in unbelievably huge numbers. This spring, the largest group of periodical cicadas, called Brood 10, has emerged for the first time in 17 years, and is overwhelming portions of the East and Midwest, from the Mississippi to the mid-Atlantic coastline. No one can say exactly how many there are. Estimates range as high as 10 trillion, perhaps the largest insect emergence on Earth. And cicada mania is in the air. Fun for some children.
It's really cool.
Not for others.
They look ugly and they're scary.
Websites to track sightings. Cicada ice cream cones, not real cicadas.
A little garlic butter.
And cooking recipes, real cicadas. Most excited of all, entomologists who study the insects. One is Mike Raup of the University of Maryland, who took us to a suburban neighborhood near his campus for a cicada life cycle tour.
Let's have a look. We'll talk
beginning
about
the with their emergence
cycle.
From the ground.
Here, look at this. This is incredible. They build a tunnel or an escape chimney out of the ground. These will be anywhere from 8 to maybe 12 or 18 inches deep. They're simply waiting for the soil temperature to reach the mid-60s. That's an indication that it's going to be warm enough for the adults to get up out of the ground, move into the vegetation, molt, fly, mate, sing, and complete the biological imperative.
Under every one of these rocks, a bunch of little holes.
Well,
right?
Look, this is incredible. Maybe in a square foot, 17. In certain locations, there can be as many as 100,000 to 1.5 million cicadas per acre. This is a really good site right here.
So a whole world under the under our feet.
Yeah, and it's been there working along for 16 long years.
What are they doing for all those years?
That's a great question. They've been attached to the roots of trees and other plants underground, and they feed on a tissue called xylem. This is a nutrient-poor tissue that carries water, minerals, and some nutrients up to the top of the tree.
Once out of the ground, a cicada heads for plants or trees and sheds its outer skin.
What I keep wondering, how do they know when it's time to come up?
Well, underground, they're deprived of any kind of light cues, so what we think is they actually attach to the roots of trees and measure the annual fluxes in nutrients and perhaps hormones that occur in the plant. They have a biological clock or a molecular clock that allows them to count those 17 years.
Notice Raup said, we think. There's plenty about these cicadas that remains uncertain. Most interesting, perhaps, is why they return in such numbers and why they have such curious prime-numbered life terms. Periodical cicadas are on a 13 or 17-year cycle. What's for certain is that when they do appear, a mass slaughter takes place. For dogs, squirrels, and birds, it's a feast.
They're incredibly easy prey. They have virtually no defenses. Right now, everything on this planet wants to eat a cicada.
But millions do survive. And that's led scientists to theorize that the mysterious ways of periodical cicadas are a survival strategy.
The whole game on the periodical cicada is to emerge in massive numbers simultaneously and simply overwhelm the predators that want to eat them or that are there to eat them. There are enough cicadas that will emerge to basically fill everybody's belly and still leave enough to reproduce and perpetuate the species.
So overwhelm the enemy,
right,
in such vast numbers, and the goal is just survival.
Exactly.
As many as can survive.
Exactly, that's right. It's a safety numbers game. The strategy is called predator satiation. You simply make the predators that are out there so full that there's a number that will actually survive. Very bizarre, very clever strategy, and by golly, it sure has worked for tens of thousands of years.
Indeed, humans have taken notice of cicadas for thousands of years. Their red eyes were said to come from staring into the fires of Hades underground. Ancient poets, including Homer, referred to the cicada's song, performed exclusively by the males.
Now you can tell the male because he has a blunt abdomen. Oops, it's rounded on the back, blunt abdomen. But if we lift up the wing and look very carefully, just beneath the wing, we'll see an organ called the timbal organ. That white membrane at the end of my thumb, you can see it vibrating, is how he makes that sound, and it's only the male that will call.
Holding a male to his microphone, Raup allowed us to record a cicada soundbite.
So just that vibration makes this sound we're hearing.
It's incredible. It's the timbal organ, and also the abdomen is largely hollow. We believe it acts as an amplification chamber to amplify this noise and make a sound that can reach as high as 80 to 85 decibels. That's the sound of a large truck going down the street or a garbage disposal. It's pretty noisy.
When millions of these guys are up in the trees together, it's a regular din, and it's all about one thing.
These are very romantic arthropods. The males will chorus, And this basically helps the different species of cicada to go to the same tree. There are three species that will emerge simultaneously in this brood 10. Once they're sorted out by species, he will shift over to a series of courtship songs, which basically try to convince that special someone that he should be the father of her nymphs.
You can hear the differences in these three examples, as the male sings a distinct song to attract females of his own species.
If he's successful, she will signify her acceptance with a little fan dance with her wings, allow him to mate, and then he'll go off and find other ladies. She'll be left with the task of laying the eggs in the small branches. After about 4 to 6 weeks, those eggs will hatch, and the little tiny nymphs, now about the size of small ants, will take an incredible leap of faith out of the tops of these trees, down to the earth below, burrow down anywhere from 1 to 3 feet underground, and spend the next 16, almost 17 years feeding on tree roots underground.
Cycle continues.
The circle of life.
For their part, the adult cicadas die quickly, soon after they're done with their mating and breeding duties. So 17 years underground, 4 to 6 weeks above, and it's over. But while it's happening, it's a bonanza for scientists.
It's a unparalleled opportunity to learn about nature, ecology, evolution, behavior, all the various aspects of biology. So a million mysteries, a million unanswered questions.
So while you're waiting for the next brood 10, what happens to you for the next 17 years?
Well, I've got a subterranean office, and I'll go down there for 16 years and write papers and grants, and hopefully in the 17th year, they'll let me back up to tell more bug stories.
Cicada mania is expected to last until the end of June, when the brood 10 adults are all dead and countless little nymphs are tunneling back into the ground to await their next appearance in 2021.
A lot can happen in 17 years, but some memories, especially those of a mass invasion of insects, don't fade. We asked some of our viewers what they remember from the last two emergences, and here's what they had to say.
The thing that I remember the most from the last emergence was just the sheer numbers of them. I was taking classes at the Johns Hopkins Homewood campus. It was absolutely insane how many there were, both the bugs, the exoskeletons, the corpses. You literally could not even see the sidewalks, and it got so bad that you couldn't wear sandals walking through campus, or you'd end up with cicadas between your toes.
What I really vividly remember is the previous emergence in 1987. The cicadas came and they were everywhere, all over the trees, all over the ground, all over the house. And I decided that they would also be all over me. So I would cover myself in cicadas and go up to my parents and basically be a small decorated 7-year-old child with cicadas all over them, which probably was a little horrifying, but thought it was the coolest thing ever.
As the nymphs started coming out of the ground and heading everywhere into the trees and the leaves and our fences to molt, I would go out at night and I would just stop and just listen. And you could hear them crawling out of the ground and crawling along. It sounded like Rice Krispies after you poured the milk.
Back in 2004, my husband and I, we were just dating then for about 6 or 7 months, and we took a big trip out to see one of his close friends in the Maryland area, not knowing that there was going to be cicadas at all. And he parked across the street from the house, looked at me and said, "Every man for himself," and then he just dove out of the car, ran across the street to his friend's house, and I was just left in the car wondering, what the heck is this?
Maybe I was running across the street to like get a blanket so I can come back out, you know, but by the time I went and got the blanket, maybe you were already, that's what I was thinking.
No, that wasn't what you were thinking. It must've worked out though. I mean, I still agreed to marry you. So
yeah, that was a test.
I had a car without air conditioning, so I had the window open. Now, as I was driving along, something came flying into my window and hit me in the head, and then was flying around in my car and hitting me more in the head, kind of a little stunned. It somehow got into a grocery bag, and the grocery bag was looked like it was breathing. It was buzzing around with this creature in it and everything. So I had to fling that out. And that's when the cicada flew out. I will not be driving around with my window down while the cicadas are out.
I love driving with my windows open. And I had the music up, started opening up the windows. And before I knew it, I think I had the windows maybe open for 5 minutes. Before I knew it, a giant cicada came flying in the window, landed right here, bounced into the backseat of my car. I had a welt. It looked like those stripes that they put for the football players on. I had a welt that size right here for about 3 weeks.
And also during the height of them too, when you're out and about, they're flying, they're bouncing into you. And if you look up, they're like crisscrossing. It's like, you need like an air traffic controller. I mean, they're everywhere. And they're like, you know, birds are chasing after them to eat them. And you walk around, all of a sudden you're like one on your shoulder and you're like, ah! I mean, they don't bite or anything, but still it's kind of unsettling to turn and see this like 2-inch long bug with red eyes staring right at you.
These things are landing on you and they're so big and quite honestly, pretty hideous to look at. And I'm looking for the word Boeing. They're so big on them, you know, and they have these big red heads. They're on your clothes. They're not afraid of anything, it doesn't seem.
One afternoon we were at a Walmart parking lot and my daughter was almost 4 and she was totally fine with the bugs until one flew into her hair at the Walmart parking lot and she totally flipped out. And we said, don't worry, you know, you'll be almost 21 by the time these bugs come back. And she turns 21 this summer and she's been dreading this day since she was 4 years old.
I was a preschool teacher. So I was doing my summer home visits of next year's students and little Rebecca, not Becky, Rebecca, she told me that first off. She took me out in her backyard, which most kids would take you in their bedroom and show you their dolls, but she had treasures to show me. And she had sand pails full of shells and carcasses, and her older sister was horrified.
The dog we had at the time, he would just binge on the little nymphs in the shell before they, you know, just as they came out of the ground, and then also the full-grown cicadas. So much so, he gained several pounds, and we had to cut back on his regular food. Because he was eating so many of them.
My parents had, I guess they were probably 6-month-old puppies, a pair of them. And they were in absolute heaven every time we went out. I mean, it was like the weirdest game of Pac-Man possible because we just go outside and these two little puppies, they had so much energy. They jump around if there are any like bumbling low-growth flyers or if there are any kind of crawling on the ground trying to figure out where they were going. It got to the point where like, we don't even have to feed the dogs. Like every time they'd go out, it was like snack time.
Now that I have the choice, I love Oceanside, California, but I do miss my family in New York. I miss seeing my Mets, and all I have to do is wait a little bit of time, but I will wait.
This explosion of cicadas is a fascinating biological phenomenon, and a lot of you had questions about this event as well. So for our last cicada segment, we got together two entomologists, Mike Ropp, who you've met before, and Jessica Ware, to try to answer some of those questions. Jessica and Mike, thank you both so much for being here. And first off, I just have to imagine, I wonder if you could each reflect on this for a moment, that as I was saying, this is some of your life's work, and helping people understand the natural world is what you guys do. But this has to be a particularly special moment when this kind of thing comes along. Mike, do you feel that way about this time?
Yeah, this is kind of our Super Bowl, William. I mean, we chase these things around. We wait with bated breath for 17 years. And then when they're up and out of the ground, it is just spectacular. It's nonstop. I mean, we're going to see everything here. We're going to see birth. We're going to see death. Yeah. We're going to see predators chasing these things. We're going to see romance in the treetop up in the big boy band. It's going to be better than an episode of Game of Thrones, and it only comes along once every 17 years. So this is kind of our Super Bowl. It's spectacular.
Okay, Jessica, that's kind of unfair if he uses up every possible superlative there is to describe it. It's not really fair, but what do you think? It's just like a nice walk in the park for you?
I think this is one of my most favorite things to witness. I think as a biologist, especially someone who studies evolution, it can be hard sometimes to really communicate to students or to your family members you know, why evolution is interesting and why biology in general is full of these phenomena that we should stop and pay attention to. So when you have something remarkable that's actually out of the ordinary, cute, you know, huge groups of cicadas all over trees, it kind of forces people to stop. And then they can you can really introduce, you know, these topics about evolution, about selection, about, you know, long geological periods of time. And I don't know, those are dry topics to talk about with your family members unless you have trillions of cicadas kind of accompanying as an example.
Yeah, it helps if the ground is suddenly boiling with them and you can be like, look, this is the stuff I was talking to you about in the textbooks. Here it is right here in your backyard. Mike, could you explain just why is it that they're coming out now? We know that it's every 12 to 17 years they've been waiting. Why are they coming now?
Well, it's an excellent question. The very long life cycle, basically, William, is a way for them to defeat their predators. By being underground for 13 or 17 years, there simply is no bird, there's no small mammal, there's no reptile, there's no amphibian that can track you in time. So the long life cycle basically defeats the predator tracking. The other magical part about this is prime numbers. Prime numbers ensures, because they're only divisible by themselves and one, it ensures that everybody emerges lockstep because they've got one of the craziest strategies for survival of any creature on the planet. It's called predator satiation. You emerge massively, synchronously, in such great numbers that you fill the belly of every predator that wants to eat you, and there's still enough left over to perpetuate the three species. Boom. Who does that? Periodical cicadas have been at it for a million years. They've got it down. It works.
So Jessica, the point being that they just throw so many of them out there in the natural world. I mean, my dog is, I know, one of the ones that is thrilled to have this emergence. She loves to chomp on them. But Mike is saying that the predators out there who might be waiting and hoping for these guys to emerge simply will get full, and that they can't, that enough of them will survive that the species goes on. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, when you think about it, each species, their goal is to pass on their genes to the next generation. So as an individual cicada, the hope is that all the cicadas around you get eaten and you don't. And that way you'll be able to survive, mate, and pass your genes on to the next generation. And with the squirrels' bellies being full, the cats and dogs being full, there's a good chance that, you know, you'll be able to do that job.
I forgot to mention, you both also have some guests with you today that I wonder if you could introduce. Jessica, tell us who's with you today and give us a good look at them.
Well, I'm going to give mine a name since I know that that you'll also have names for yours. But I've got some nymphs here. I'm not sure if you can see them if it's too blurry. But I have some small cicada nymphs here. These are ones that have expired already. But this insect that I'm holding is 17 years old, which is kind of remarkable. I think when we think of juvenile insects, we think of them as being very young. For some reason in my mind, I picture them being 2 months old perpetually, no matter what insect it is that I hold. But this is a 17-year-old insect that I'm holding that I collected from the ground near my home in Princeton.
Fantastic.
This is the thing that would crawl up. It's been living underground for 17 years. It would crawl up and then shed this nymphal skin to the adult stage.
And Mike, who have you got there joining you?
Well, I've got this one right here is Sally. this one is her sister Lily. And I don't know where the other ones went. I had four running around here when we first started this, and somehow Maggie and the other one, Leslie, I don't know, they've kind of disappeared. So I'm going to see
you
later tonight.
You've clearly got your hands.
You know, this is, William, this is what we call a bug eye.
My gosh, I didn't know that entomologists also had this incredible sense of humor as well.
Oh, this is not humor. This is insanity. Yeah.
Oh, that's what it is. I was wondering about the fine balance between those two things. Let's get to some of the questions that are starting to come in. Barbara on Facebook is asking, will their noise at the height of their emergence cause adults to want to stay indoors? Anyone who has lived through one of these emergences knows that there comes this incredible cacophony when they're up in the treetops and singing out. How loud does that get, and is it going to drive some people to run indoors? Mike, you want to take that?
Yeah. Well, it's going to reach anywhere from about 80 to 105 decibels, the sound of jet aircraft going by or lawnmower engines. While some may want to run indoors, I'm going to certainly be running outdoors. They've already started to chorus here in my neighborhood in Columbia, Maryland. So it's otherworldly. It sounds to me, one species sounds like an alien spaceship landing. That's the septemdecims. The other sounds kind of like an electrical transformer shorting out. Those are the cassinis. And the deculas, they're just kind of mellow. So they're more like tree crickets. So, you know, you got to choose your symphony and time it right, but go outside and listen.
And Jessica, and what is the sound that we are hearing? What is that? That obviously is not just for our enjoyment or terror, depending on your orientation. Who is it and who's making that noise? What are they saying? What are they signaling?
So males are making this noise with this organ called a timbal organ. And the noise that, like, as you were describing, the slightly different sounds, it's because there's three different species that are comprising this brood. And so, like I mentioned, each species wants to mate and pass its genes on to the next generation. But you want to mate with the same species as yourself. So those noises that males are making are actually very specific, species-specific noises, species-specific songs. And so females are listening, and they're listening for the quality of male by the quality of the song. But they're also listening to see if the male is the same species. And then if it is, that's when females can, you know, rustle their wings, and they can actually, you know, do the business of making the next generation of cicadas.
The business, that's what the scientific term for it is, I know.
It's an official term.
But Jessica, one question about that. So it's the quality of the male's voice, that's what the females are cluing in on. I get it that they want to make sure that they're mating with the same species, but is there a demonstrable, in a way that we can hear and record, distinction between what makes a male a prime mating candidate versus one who's got kind of a crummy voice?
Well, males are going to be calling long and they're going to be calling loud. And so the length of the call, the time of day when they're calling in the heat of the sun, the volume that they're producing, all of those indicate to females that a male might be a good fit for a mate. And also, if a male is really good at singing, chances are good that her sons will also be good singers. And so that's the hypothesis is called the sexy sons hypothesis. So, you know, females want their sons to be able to be chosen, right? So they want to pick males. They're likely to pass on the good singing genes, such as they are, to her sons, that her sons will be chosen, and so on and so forth, as far as genes being passed down through generations.
It's a good thing that we don't have the same characterization in the human world, because I would never have had my three children because my wife thinks I have a terrible singing voice. Mike, Roberta on Facebook is asking, why are we not hearing them yet? I've seen many empty casings on trees and the ground and others climbing up trees, but no singing just yet. When does the concert start?
Yeah, Robert, it really depends where you are right now. Our cicadas here in Columbia, Maryland started coming out in force about 4 or 5 days ago. And really the period of time from when they are able to emerge from that shell, it will take them anywhere from about 6 to 10 days before their exoskeleton is actually hard enough for them to be able to create those volumes, for the wing muscles that attach to that rigid exoskeleton to allow them to fly to the treetops to get eyeball to eyeball. So during this period, we call it the tenoral period. Those cicadas are actually becoming mature, the exoskeleton's hardening, the timbal organ and the tympana, the ear that cicadas listen with, is actually maturing and becoming functional. So it's going to take you, I would say, about a week to 10 days. So once you start to see shells underneath your trees, a week to 10 days, and with temperatures clocking in here now in the 80s this week, I think a week or 10 days later, you're going to hear that cacophony up in the treetops.
Jessica, Carolyn on Facebook is asking, Brood 10 is in small pockets in different states. Why are they so widely dispersed? Are all the individuals in each brood the same species, and are different broods made up of different species? You touched on this a little bit, but for instance, like anyone tuning in this on the West Coast is thinking, what are all these people on the East Coast going crazy about? Like, why is it that they only exist here and not further west?
Well, I mean, the reason why any species exists where it is a result of, you know, long geographic, you know, long history, right? So it has to do perhaps with the origin of where the ancestral periodical cicadas first were. But then as we've shaped the landscape, that kind of also shapes where we find broods now. So there are some broods that have gone extinct that were recorded once or twice, and then we don't find them anymore. And then to answer your question about whether the species are the same, there's slightly different compositions of species in different broods. And in part, it kind of makes sense, I guess, if you think about it. When people were documenting, you know, cicadas before genetics, before, you know, people were really extensively doing morphology on cicadas, perhaps on the East Coast, maybe it just looked like it was one giant group. But over time, people realized that there were multiple species, including, you know, some pioneering female entomologists who noted that there were some, that for example, you know, one of the species that's coming out now was actually a new species. She didn't get to name it. Male entomologist named it. I won't say on her behalf, but they just say that they named it. But it takes time to really evaluate whether or not you have multiple species. So I think that's why we're, you know, it took some time for people to realize how many species were in each brood.
Mike, Brad on Facebook is asking this question that I think is at the heart of the whole educational effort here, which is how and where is the best way to witness this phenomenon? I mean, obviously, if you're in an area where they really are coming out, you just have to step out your front door and they are there.
Right, right.
But do you have any tips? Are there times of day, locations?
Yeah.
How to enjoy this?
Well, the best way to enjoy it, I'm going to make a strong recommendation here for a free download. It's called the Cicada Safari app. This was developed by our colleague Gene Kritsky out at the University of Mount St. Joseph's in Cincinnati, Ohio. He developed this several years ago. And simply you download this free app, you go out, you take a picture of what you think might be a cicada. It comes back to us. It's geo-referenced, so we know exactly where the cicada is. And I've been using this data to predict when cicadas are going to emerge. So it gives us both location and time. Once you have that app, you can go into Cicada Safari and drill right down to street levels and find out who's got the cicadas. So it's very easy. Get the app, free download for Apple or Android systems, Cicada Safari. You'll be able to look at that and find out where cicadas are in your neighborhood. Or just give Jessica or myself a call, and we'll be happy to take you out to the field and show you where the cicadas are. You can go hang with the big boy band.
Viewers, you might have thought here that we were with two serious entomologists. No, these are two people who are more than happy to take you out, root around in the dirt, and get up close with the natural world, as every good teacher does. This is springtime, and people are going through a lot of planting of plants and flowers and trees and shrubs.
Yeah.
Katie on Facebook is asking, do the cicadas destroy flowers? Is there any concern that anyone who has planted anything or cares about any of the plants in their environment, that the cicadas will do any damage to them? Jessica, do you know, is there an answer to that?
No, I wouldn't be concerned in terms of your flowers or your gardens, whether, you know, your ornamental plants. There really isn't any risk. Some people have reported if you were planting saplings, young sapling trees, you know, right around the time when the nymphs when females are laying their eggs and the nymphs are going to burrow down. Sometimes, you know, this isn't the best time to plant fresh sapling trees. But other than that, I really wouldn't worry. And they certainly aren't going to damage your tulips, your rhododendrons, you know, your begonias, whatever. Those are cicada proof, I would say.
Right.
William, can I jump in on real quick?
Please.
What we know is the damage the females make. Jess is absolutely right. Not vegetables, but on mature trees, there's going to be what we call flagging of some branches. They're going to shrug it off. There have been several studies show no long-lasting effect on mature, well-established trees. On young saplings, what we're recommending here is to wrap them in cicada netting. And we have a video that shows people how to do this. this will protect those young trees because in some cases where cicadas are abundant, they have actually killed young saplings. What we don't want people to do is to spray cicadas with insecticides. Yeah. It's been demonstrated by myself and several other scientists. This simply does not work. If you're worried about your small trees, wrap them in cicada netting. That's going to totally eliminate that kind of damage. So that's where we'd like to recommend for folks that might be listening.
For people who haven't been following, this is because in the life cycle, after the males and the females have mated, the females burrow into the branches of trees to lay those nymphs in there initially, right? So that we, if you had a new tree, it might hurt those, a very fragile tree.
They use this egg-laying apparatus called an ovipositor, which is like a very hard, almost like a little hard knife, and they cut a little slit, and that's where they lay the eggs, and then the eggs actually are the things that hatch, and then the nymph drops down to the soil.
What was the term, an ovipositor? What was that?
Ovipositor, an egg-laying apparatus.
Fantastic. Yes. I hope they're trademarked. speaking of harms, we have to address this, the fear that some people have of creepy crawlies. In fact, our very own beloved NewsHour anchor, Judy Woodruff, indicated after a story where we talked to you, Mike, a month or so ago, she posited, well, what if they were to all get together? Couldn't they, with their wings and size, carry a human off? I mean, she was only joking, but I think she was betraying a little bit of the concern that some people have that, oh my God, this is a horror movie. This is scary to me.
Yeah.
Disabuse us of any fears we might have about this.
Well, you know, the fears are important things, and I take these very seriously. The most important thing is just as referred to here is to learn as much about these cicadas as you possibly can. Understand they don't bite, they don't sting, and they don't carry away small children and dogs like the monkeys in The Wizard of Oz. That's not happening. Okay, so William, let's not touch that one. Learn as much as you can. If you're still concerned, I recommend that you talk to a professional, a counselor, a clergyman, someone about your concerns. Try to seek a little professional help to allow you to deal with this. These kind of fears are totally normal, they happen. And finally, my last piece of advice, if you simply can't take it, get out of town. Go to Ocean City, go to upstate. No cicadas in Florida, no cicadas in the Poconos. So I actually have one individual who called me last week. He said, Mike, when are the cicadas coming? They're going to be out this week. He said, great. I've already got my ticket for Boise. I'm heading for Idaho for 3 weeks. So if you simply can't take it, simply go somewhere that will not have cicadas.
Excellent.
And importantly, if you have children, I think this is a really important time to train them to love insects. So my colleague at Rutgers, Vanessa LeBeau, has done a bunch of work that shows that insect fear is actually often taught, right? So if you're nervous and you're showing your children that you're nervous of these insects, it will just set them up to be nervous of these insects the next 17 years when they arrive again. So if you are a parent and you're able to push that down into a little ball inside and not show that to your children and really try to encourage them to see the interesting parts of the fact that this biological phenomenon is happening, it will set them up to not be afraid.
And Jessica, there's no downside to picking them up, to holding them, to being gentle with them. You're not going to do any harm to yourself or to the cicadas. Is that right? If you're relatively careful in your handling.
I was going to say, well, it depends. I mean, my children sometimes are very rough with insects when they pick them up. And the next thing you know, the abdomen is squished and the guts are kind of squeezing out the side. But no, if you're gentle, then there's really no harm to you or to them. Just be very gentle. Because especially the nymphs, some people have been really interested in digging up the nymphs when you see them, but it's very easy to damage them. Their abdomens, as I know, when my child and I went over to Princeton, we had a few mishaps. So just be gentle.
Be gentle, but we know that there's always more to replace them, thankfully. Mike, we've read, and anyone that has seen one of these cicadas up close knows that they have these incredibly striking red eyes, but we understand that there are a few that are like Paul Newman with piercing blue eyes.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Well, you know, the red-eyed pigment is what we call a screening pigment. It basically helps to screen out certain wavelengths and allow other wavelengths into their eyes that are involved with the actual visual pigment, which is called rhodopsin. So the red eyes are common in other insects. I'm sure you know that fruit flies and many other insects have red eyes. So that's fundamentally why the eyes are red. What was the other part of that question, William? That was a two-parter.
I think I threw in some awkward reference to Paul Newman. I don't think there was another question to it.
Oh, yes, thank you. But there is great variation in eye color, ranging all the way from vermilion to kind of a orange color to the blue to white. The blue eye is purported to be something like one in a million. The question is, I've heard there's a reward for finding a blue-eyed cicada, and there is indeed a reward. If you find a blue-eyed cicada, your reward is that you found a blue-eyed cicada. So that is the reward. But I see them all the time. In every brood, I'll see a blue-eyed or white-eyed. Already seen several in this brood. So go out, have a look. And when you see those beautiful Paul Newman eyes, just say, whoa.
I'm dating myself with this reference. I'm sorry, Jessica, did you want to say something there?
Oh, no, I was just laughing at that idea. But, you know, this is what students should do, or teachers that are listening. You could have, you know, your class or your students actually counting the number of different eye colors that they see, and you could learn fractions, and you could, I mean, the possibilities are endless, I think.
Jessica, staying with you for a second. Sarah on Facebook is asking, and this is something I've certainly wondered about because of my dog's eating habits. Are the cicadas harmful to dogs or to cats?
No, they're not harmful. So, I mean, it's expected that a lot of mammals are going to be consuming these. They're going to be chowing down. And, I mean, my dog usually tends to eat everything completely. sometimes you see squirrels and they're actually delicately kind of chewing around and leaving the legs, which have some spines on them. But my dogs, I'm assuming, will just consume them whole. But they consume lots of insects whole. And your insect, your cats or your dogs that you're talking about probably are doing this all throughout the summer. Every summer, you just may not, you know, be paying that much attention. Now, sure, they have a bit more in the cornucopia to choose from, but probably.
And it's so loud. You can, like, my dog is eating these, and it's like she's got a bowl of Cheetos in front of her. It's just the crunch.
It's high protein and fat. I don't know the exact exact nutritional breakdown, but I know that there's, you know, high protein and fat. So maybe it's probably better for them than Cheetos.
Mike, speaking of the dietary qualities of these, humans like them too, including you.
Yeah, I've eaten some cicadas. I was actually working with a PBS and MPT crew last night, and the young lady, we were filming around 10 o'clock, and she was kind of looking at them, and she said, well, do humans eat them? I said, sure. And I said, watch. And I grabbed one of the molting ones, one of the 10 or adults. Some of them are simply going to fail. They can't get out of the exoskeleton. So the ones that have crinkled wings, you just pop them in your mouth. They have a buttery texture, a nutty flavor. And I said, do you want to try one? And sure enough, she did. She said it tasted like peanut butter. There are lots of recipes. I fed cicadas to Jay Leno in 2013. Russell Crowe declined the cicada. He said there are no cicadas on Krypton. Leno said they're better than Cheeto, so go figure. There are lots of good recipes. The Cicadalicious Cookbook has cicada recipes in it. So give it a try.
Jessica, have you tried them?
I've tried cicadas and all sorts of insects, but I haven't really had periodical cicadas lovingly prepared. So my friend at Brooklyn Bugs is going to be preparing some nice nymphs for me. Actually, I'm meeting him right after I leave this call to go and collect some that he's going to cook. So I can't wait.
That's fantastic.
But with regular, with annual cicadas, I've had them sautéed, and like Mike was saying, very nutty, delicious. Highly recommend.
We are continuing to get more and more questions here. Let me just ask you, so we know that Anne Marie on Facebook is asking, do they bite humans? I think the answer to that is no. Anna on Facebook is asking an interesting question, because it is, what about when the soil is paved over? And obviously, I guess this is about how humans might have changed the physical landscape and whether or not that impacts the emergence of these bugs. Is it possible that the way we've changed the landscape affects in some ways the emergence of these creatures?
Yeah, absolutely. The biggest insult came during our colonial period when we chopped down all their trees. They have to have trees. So that was a big issue. When we pave it over and create impervious surface, they're gone forever, William. And this is one of the big threats. We're very concerned. As Jessica said, we've already lost brood 11, which used to be in Connecticut, and brood 21 in northern Florida. We're hoping we see the return of brood 10 on Long Island, but certainly development is a major threat and to extirpate local populations. However, the good news is, as our farms now revert to parks, to neighborhoods like mine where people have planted trees, cicadas are actually doing better. So as long as we have a forest refuge that can serve as that reserve for cicadas, as we begin to plant more trees and let more trees grow, better times for cicada, impervious surface, it's the death knell. So it's going both ways right now.
Let me take this last question. This is Kieran on Facebook is asking, how do you tell male from female? We were talking a little bit about their voices. Why are the ones with the hardened exoskeleton still slow and lethargic? So two questions there, but Jessica, how do we tell the male from female?
Well, one of the ways that's pretty easy is the structure we talked about before, the egg laying apparatus, the ovipositor, which looks almost like a dark colored, it's called sclerotide, so it's a hardened structure at the tip of the abdomen, almost kind of like a ski slope or something like that. I always think it looks like a ski jump. And that is what females have, so that you know that you have a female. But then you could also look for the timbal organ in males, which is the organ that's used to make sound, which almost looks like a little washboard. Maybe that's a dated reference to call something a washboard since nobody uses washboards anymore. But like kind of like a corrugated surface kind of at the base of the abdomen on the underside. And then you would know that you had a male. Oh, there it is.
So there's the ovipositor that Jess was talking about.
Hold that back a little bit, Mike. Yeah, there we go.
See the pointy structures.
Got it. Fantastic. I love that term. We are at the 2 o'clock hour, and I know we are going to let you two go. I cannot thank you both enough for doing this. Jessica Ware, Mike Ropp, two brilliant entomologists. Thank you so much for sharing your expertise and your love and your knowledge of these wonderful creatures that are living amongst us now. Great to see you. Thank you both very much for being here.
Thanks for having us.
Thank
and
you.
I'm nice William. Thank you, Mike. I'm William Brangham at the PBS NewsHour. Thank you guys so much for joining us. This is such an interesting topic. We have a lot more stories and write-ups that we've been doing on our website. Please look there at pbs.org/newshour. But for now, thank you very much for joining us, and we'll see you next time.